What's your name?
Bobby Worthy.
What's your name?
Reverend Larry O'Hara.
Okay, and we're going to find out later who you are. But the bottom line is that I understand that you was incarcerated a few weeks ago before you go in the courthouse to do what you got to do. Could you talk about your incarceration? Was it in Blackshear or?
It was here in Waycross.
Okay, and you was in the jail, right?
Yes.
Could you tell us a little bit about the jail situation? First of all, why were you in jail? And okay. Then from there, tell us about what you discovered.
Well, I went to jail for an alleged technical violation of my misdemeanor probation. I went to jail on February 29th.
How did you violate your probation?
They said it was a technical violation. They said I didn't call back when the probation officer called. But I did.
Okay.
I got locked up on February 29th, and I got out on March the 4th, which is, I stayed 7 days, which was the following Monday. I stayed 7 days in jail during my time in incarceration, and I think it was a blessing for me to be there because I know now there's injustice inside the jail with inmates. I experienced officers' rude, obnoxious behavior, abusive language, even horse playing. A lot of the guys, younger guys, the officers like to play games with them. And as soon as the officers in a bad mood and they want to play with them, they want to pull rank, throw them in a hole. Some of the alleged violations is they're not unauthorized. The law library, not legally by law, they're supposed to give you 1 hour a day in the law library. The law library is inadequate. It has books that's not in it. Books is out of date. That's illegal. And as you're going back and forth to court, you're completely shackled.
Before you go to that, how do you know the books was outdated, number one, and number two, how do you know they're supposed to be updated?
The law states that they're supposed to give you, and the law library is supposed to be updated, and you're supposed to have 1 hour a day. The books are supposed to be updated because the laws, while you're incarcerated, the books that they give you to go by, then if the new law is higher or lesser, then they got to go by what the books they gave you by, what law they give you. But they don't allow the inmates to get in there, because I put in 4 or 5 requests and never got in there. But as I was saying, we got the conditions of medical. First of all, medical, and I'll get back to the chain, but medical personnel. I witnessed medical personnel touching medication with their bare hands and giving it to the inmates to put in their mouth. Numerous times, for 7 days, every day, I filed a grievance on that. Never heard anything about that. The nurse actually physically taking her hand and touching inmates' medicine that they got to put in their mouth.
Did you get anybody's name?
No. They don't have name tags, the nurses don't.
Did you get any witnesses?
Yes, I got inmates' witnesses and stuff. And even that, as my first day in incarceration, what they did was they took blood pressure from me. They had my insulin, you know, because I'm a diabetic. They checked my blood sugar twice. My blood pressure twice. And immediately, never saw a doctor, no kind of test anyway. The next day, the nurse tried to put me on high blood pressure medicine. I told her, I'm not taking that medicine because I haven't seen a doctor. I say everybody's blood pressure goes up and down. And a few days before I got out, they say, oh, it's fine. I said, oh, but the doctor never saw him one time, and he put me on high blood pressure med. Then he changed my insulin. I explained to the doctor in medical. I explained to the nurse that I see a diabetes specialist. All right? How then can the doctor change my insulin when I see a diabetes specialist and he's not a diabetes specialist? I say that would be a conflict of interest. And luckily, I just refused to take that medicine because I didn't want to put myself at risk. The other violations are, like I said,
there are other people who are kind of forced or intimidated and go ahead on and follow that procedure?
Yes, all of them. Most of them are intimidated by everything in that jail they do. I guess I'm from a different cut, different breed. I witnessed being in shackles, a shackles, complete shackles, walking from the back to the front in shackles, without an escort, without an officer, 147 feet. I counted it, 147 feet up and 147 feet back in shackles. The law says anytime you are in handcuffs, you must be in arm's reach of an officer. There's no officer just calling us from the day back. If someone fall in the middle of there, they're just going to sit there. Then you have to wait till I'm open the doors. That's another grievance I filed. Never heard anything on that. And far as the situation why I'm here today, officers are routinely taking inmate stuff that they purchase off the store. If I buy that off the store, I personally, it's my property. You cannot deprive me of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. And let's understand this. When you violate due process of law, that's a federal offense. According to the U.S. Title 18, Section 241, that's conspiracy against one's right. It says whenever two or more persons come together and deprive you of the right that's secured by the United States Constitution, it is a federal offense that carries 10 years imprisonment. And I'm sick of it. I'm tired of it. Like I told them in there, you can take my freedom. You can take my choices of where to be and where to stand, but you will never take my drive and my passion to destroy injustice and racial brutality across this country.
So when they arrested you, it was to your advantage in terms of you capturing information and, as some say, the minute of the moment?
Yes, it was an honor to be arrested because I wouldn't know what I know now.
All right. So short form, in closing, before you go in the courthouse there, I would like to ask you this question. I want you to do a short summation of how do you view the jail and what needs to be done. Short form.
Short form, the sheriff needs to step up and take more interactive into the jail process itself. Because it's possible, and I'm going to say Randy Rawl is a good sheriff. Don't get me wrong. He handles a lot of stuff for us, and he has always done that. But I do believe he really does not go into jail like he should be. Every sheriff should go inside or have access to watch everything that go on in that jail.
That's it?
That's it.
All right, now, let me ask you this question then, since you didn't address it. Do you believe that what you have found out, I'm retired military, to me, it should not be up to the sheriff. There should be a check and balance from the state. It seems as if, though, maybe, in my opinion, somebody from the state need to come down and review to make sure that the sheriff is in compliance. I know he's a constitutional person, but at the same time, if nobody come down and inspect from the state, then that's what you got.
And you're right, you're correct. See, each one of them has a boss. The sheriff has to answer to the state and the county, of course, because the state is his own constitutional officer, the sheriff is. He and the county commissioner controls his budget, but they don't control his office.
Anything else? You have any comments, my brother?
Something on the lines a little different from this.
Okay.
I'm having problems in Southeast Georgia with the school system because the school system predominantly is all white. Our kids are at home, and then with their black family or mixed family, but when they go to school, they have to face all white people. And the kids are having a problem with that, but no one is really addressing it. The reason I'm saying this is because recently I went over to Hazelhurst, Georgia to investigate where a young man was in school. He's about 8 or 9 years old, and he raised his hand to use the bathroom, they wouldn't let him, so he used the bathroom on himself. The very next day, the same thing happened. When we went to the school system, they are saying, yes, it happened, but it was an accident. But it's something that should not have never happened. Now, if that had been a black teacher with a white kid, that teacher would have been fired, but that teacher is still there. And what I'm doing now, I'm still in investigative mode, but something needs to be done about this. There's no reason why all of these schools down south don't have one black teacher. Some of them don't have one black teacher, and they have as many as 4,500 kids, but there's no black people there. No one that their kids can feel safe and comfortable.
Who did you notify about this situation? On the state, on a local, state, or national level?
Well, before I had a situation in Douglas, Georgia.
No, let's deal with this one you just called
this
me.
This one?
Yeah.
Well, I'm still investigating right now. But I did go to the school itself, and the school superintendent was completely 100% on the teacher's side. So now I'm preparing to go to the state, Georgia State Board of Education, and the Civil Rights Division, you know, or the Georgia State Board of Education.
Okay, that was problems in Douglas, Georgia, up there. Whatever happened to that young lady up there in Douglas? Was it Douglas we went to?
It was, which one? Because I've been to Douglas several times.
The one that I went with, I only been to one.
With that young lady, I don't remember what happened with that one, but okay. The last one was the school's assistant superintendent was fired and the teachers was fired.
What was that about?
Oh, that was the same one. You was there for that, but that young man was a young man. Yeah, the school superintendent, assistant superintendent was fired, that black guy was fired. And the teacher, she was fired, and the nurse was also let go because that was a special needs kid, and she didn't even know what medicine the kid was taking. They were fired.
Okay. That's what I want to know about. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay.